Greetings, everyone. This is Fred Coulter. Welcome to Church at Home. Church at Home is dedicated to restoring original Christianity for today and the truth of the Bible, as well as keeping up on what is happening in the world. Now, here's a report. They call themselves Christian witches. Now, that's an oxymoron, or the way I like to say it's so insane, it's a morioxon. Yet they say, we're good witches. We help people. We cast spells. We bring them riches.
Now we're grown, we can do as we please and as we desire, and we create our own path and our own soul journey and our own spiritual path, and it is a delight to create it.
Here's what is claimed by the Christian witches ahead of their first convention. Jesus was a sorcerer. That is like saying, Jesus is Satan. Now, how twisted and demented can people's thinking get? And who does this come from? Does it come from God? Or does it come from Satan? Now, as we go through this, I want you to ask yourself the question, how many lies do I believe? And in what ways have I been deceived? Especially if you are a professing Christian. Now, where are we in the things concerning prophecy? And why is this important, and why has this come up now? Well, we find in Revelation 12 and verse 9, and the great dragon, now stop and think about this for a minute. All religions, ancient religions, go back to serpentism, right? Every single one does. And that great dragon was cast out, the ancient serpent, who is called the devil and Satan, who is deceiving the whole world. He was cast down to the earth, and his angels were cast down with him. Now, what about angels of Satan? They are called demons. See, because Satan, the devil, wanted to be God and become like the Most High, Isaiah 14. So he persuaded one-third of the angels to go to war against God the Father and Jesus Christ. And they were cast down. That's how in Genesis we find the earth was in the Hebrew, tohu and bohu, in chaos and confusion, and covered with a flood because of that war. Now, his final judgment has not come, so Satan is still alive and well and is deceiving the whole world. Now, I want you to think about that. Are people deceived in religion? Are they deceived in politics? Are they deceived in medical care? Are they deceived in education? Are they deceived in banking? Are they deceived in all of these things? Who do you suppose has inspired the world system today? None other than Satan the devil. And isn't it interesting how many of the world leaders are now being exposed for what they really are? I just got a new, very thick book, Inside the Closet in the Vatican. You want the truth? Are you a Catholic? You better rethink that and get to the Bible instead of your traditions. 90% of the priests, bishops, archbishops, cardinals, nuncios, College of Cardinals, and the popes are all practicing homosexuals. An abomination to God. They don't represent God. not the true God. They represent a God who is Satan the devil. And that's what he's called in 2 Corinthians 4:4. Satan the devil is the God of this world or age. Now then, let's read a little bit more here about witchcraft, so-called Christian witches. There are two, Reverend Valerie Love and Prophet Calvin Whitaker. Here is their picture. Isn't it interesting how similar that their physiognomy really is? Now, they're going to have a convention in April. And guess where they're going to have it? In Salem, Massachusetts. It'll be the first annual Christian Witches Convention set to be hosted in Salem, Massachusetts this April, and will feature internationally recognized prophet Calvin Whitaker, who agrees with the convention host that Jesus was a sorcerer. And the Bible is really a book of magic. So Valerie Love is a practicing Christian witch and ordained minister of spiritual consciousness. She launched the Covenant of Christian Witches Mystery School to help Christians tap into magic. Now, notice what she believes. She insists there's nothing wrong with the idea of Christians practicing magic despite the biblical warnings against it. The Bible is a huge book of sorcery. You can't get around Jesus being a magician. There's just no way. Whitaker pointed to the miracles from Jesus' adult ministry as clear examples of sorcery. You're talking about sorcery at its base understanding. It's really just being able to change the natural by supernatural means. And we will see, yes, Satan and the demons can do phenomenal things. We'll see that's even recorded in the Bible here in a little bit. And he says, that's really it. That's what the Bible is all about. It's an alchemical process. It's to say that you turn water into wine, 2 fish and 5 loaves into bread, feeding the multitude, absolutely forms of sorcery. Then he says, walking on water, and etc. This is what the witches believe, and Satan has deceived them into believing. You're talking about the whole of Jesus' adult ministry is all magic, all sorcery.
You know, I love how you say it, that, you know, you love the Christ and the craft. And I kind of take that mantra on too. And then the other side of me really understands that God is expansive, God is evolving, and it's beyond our comprehension and our creeds. And so then I find myself in a space that I love the scriptures, I love Christ, I love the Bible, love the Christian dogma and creed. Going into magic was actually a very easy segue. It didn't feel unusual. It felt actually at home. The only thing that it did was it expanded the power outside of the particular practice, and it expanded the power outside of the particular philosophy. You know, we have a community and we do ceremony, we do rituals. We've done money magic. We've done some other things, warding off other entities that we don't necessarily want to work with at that particular time.
I feel like Christianity and magic are like this. And even when you read a lot of the old grimoires, it's totally prayers. It's totally prayers. And I feel, for me, it's so natural for them to be integrated.
You know, it's interesting. I will say most of it comes from a space of just learning and education. The Bible is not against magic. The Bible is a magic book. The Bible is a grimoire.
I have said that so many times, and man, damn. I'm taking a lot of heat for that, and I really don't care, because it's one of the best magic books that I have ever found in my life.
Absolutely. The Bible is a huge book of sorcery. You literally can't get around that. You can't get around Jesus being a magician. You're talking about the whole of Jesus' ministry. you know, at least adult ministry, I should say it that way, is all magic, it's all sorcery, back and forth. And you honestly just can't, even if we just said Jesus, every particular miracle Jesus does defies human law. It defines the laws of the universe and the world. So it's interesting, you can't really talk about being a Jesus follower but not doing what Woo! Jesus did, which is Woo! Magic. Part of that would be, instead of me using magic, I become it. Instead of using a tool, I am the tool. Instead of using the Christ, I am the Christ.
Can you imagine people believing that? Have you ever heard of the Burning Man Convention in Nevada? Well, take a look at what they do. Now, let's ask the question, what does God say in the Bible about sorcery? First of all, Jesus said concerning God's word, your word is the truth. John the 17th chapter. Let's come to 2 Timothy, the 3rd chapter, and see how the Bible was written. Verse 16, all scripture is God breathed. And actually, the Greek means God spirited. In other words, the Spirit of God inspired the men to write what God wanted them to write. We'll see that again here in just a minute. And is profitable for doctrine, for conviction, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. Okay? Come here to 2 Peter, the 1st chapter. Now, as we're turning there, remember this. Men always want to alter the Bible. Bring their ideas into it, bring their traditions into it, take a snippets of the Bible, and make a great, vast doctrine of men. Now then, this is what they're doing with so-called Christian witches. And they are trying to say that the whole Bible is nothing but a big book of sorcery. There can't be any lie greater than that. 1 Peter 1, verse 19. We also possess the confirmed prophetic word, to which you do well to pay attention as to a light shining in a dark place. And there can't be anything more dark than so-called Christian sorcery, and add to that the darkness of infant killing. Let's go on. Do well to pay attention to as a light shining in a dark place until the day dawns. That's the return of Christ. The morning star arises in your hearts. That's the resurrection. Knowing this first. This is the first understanding you need to have about the Word of God. That no prophecy of Scripture, and that means pronouncement of it by God. And you read Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. God said. God spoke. You read the prophets. The Word of God, who became Christ, came to the prophet saying, speak these words. Okay? All comes from God. That no prophecy of Scripture originated as anyone's own private interpretation. And anyone who tries to add to it or take away from it, God says, you're going to be thrown into the lake of fire. You read the last couple verses of Revelation 22. Because prophecy was not brought at any time by human will, but holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. All right, let's see what Moses wrote concerning witches and sorcery. Quite a thing. All right, let's come to Deuteronomy 18. These words came from God's mouth written by Moses. Now, verse 10, there shall not be found among you anyone who makes his son or daughter to pass through the fire. Child sacrifice. We're coming to that today. Infanticide, abortion after birth. Or that uses divination, good charm, tarot cards, familiar spirits, or an observer of times. Now we have a book. You need to get it. Occult Holidays or God's Holy Days, which? Because if you keep the holidays of this world, you already halfway agree with the so-called Christian witches.
Happy Halloween. This is by far my favorite, and I do mean my favorite holiday. This is my Christmas. The times of great change have come to me during autumn, like when I came out as a trans woman. This is just a time of nostalgia and reflection and being thankful. I know people do that during Thanksgiving. I personally hate Thanksgiving. So, I mean, what about you? What are those moments for you? What's your favorite holiday? What's the time of year that fills you with the most joy and nostalgia and whatnot? Anyway, I'm off to go make some plans, crash some parties, cause some ruckus. It's gonna be awesome. Have a safe Halloween / Samhain.
The holidays of this world are not of God. And if they're not of God, who is the God of this world that inspired them? None other than Satan, the devil. We already read about that. You need to stop and think and understand, what do you believe? Where are you going? Why do you believe what you believe? And have you proved what is true? Have you proved what is right? What have you done? We are to prove the Word of God. We are to love the Word of God. We are to obey the Word of God. That's why Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God. Do you do that? Let's read on. Things we should not do. Observer of times, or a fortune teller, or a witch, or a charmer, or a consulter with familiar spirits, or a wizard. That's a male witch. Or one who seeks oracles from the dead. For all that do these things are an abomination to God. And that means it can never be accepted by God under any circumstances, regardless of the declarations of men and women who believe Satan instead of God. And that's what it is. Now notice, and because of these abominations, the Lord your God drives them out from before you. Now, you go back and read the first segment of the last two, God's judgment. And if you think that God is going to accept this, no, this is going to build up into a whole nother fiasco for the American people, because that is going headlong after Satan the devil. Now let's come to Exodus 22 and verse 18. Here is what should be done to witches. Now they tried this in Salem, Massachusetts, and unfortunately they found out that the disorientation of those women was because they ate contaminated rye.
The Salem witch trials are traditionally explained as a form of mass hysteria, political sniping, or Puritanism gone amok. But what if there were another reason?
And what if that reason was bread? Rye, to be specific.
In the 1970s, psychologist Linda Caporal theorized that a fungus called Claviceps purpurea might have had something to do with the witches in Salem. The fungus is commonly found on rye grains, and when ingested, it can cause a condition called ergotism. It's either gangrenous ergotism, causing limbs to fall off, or convulsive. And convulsive ergotism matches some reports at Salem, where people accused witches of giving them symptoms, like grievous torment in the bowels, pain in the belly, pinching and pricking, and choking. Compulsive ergotism could have been the real witchcraft in Salem, because ergotism isn't just pain. Ergot's also used to synthesize LSD, and at a lower concentration has some of its hallucinogenic effects. That might explain some of the apparitions people in Salem saw, like the light one man saw quivering in his chimney. Villagers also fed a dog witch cake to see how it would react. The ingredients? A so-called witch's urine and
rye.
Now it says here, verse 18, you shall not allow a sorceress to live. Let's see that sorcery and magicians have certain powers and can do certain things, miraculous things. Let's come to Exodus 7. Let's see what happened when Moses and Aaron went to Pharaoh and challenged Pharaoh to let the people go. Now, verse 9. When Pharaoh spoke to you, saying, give a miracle for yourselves, you shall say to Aaron, take your rod and throw it in front of Pharaoh, and it shall become a snake. And Moses and Aaron went into Pharaoh and did so as the Lord commanded. And Aaron threw down his rod in front of Pharaoh and in front of his servants, and it became a snake. Oh! Quite a miracle. Now, you see, Egypt was a complete satanic witchcraft magician religion. Notice what Pharaoh did. Then Pharaoh also called the wise men and sorcerers, and they, the priests of Egypt, did the same thing with their secret arts, the secret of being in contact with Satan the devil. Yes. He gives power to people to serve him. For each man threw down his rod, and they became snakes, but Aaron's rod swallowed them up. What about that? That showed who had the real power. The real power is from God, not Satan. They come in the next time and say, let my people go. Verse 17. In this you know that I am the Lord. Behold, I will smite with the rod that is in my hand upon the waters in the river, and they shall be turned to blood. And the fish of the river shall die, and the river shall stink, and the Egyptians shall hate to drink the water of the river. And the Lord spoke to Moses, say to Aaron, take your rod and stretch your hand over the waters of Egypt, upon their streams, upon their canals, upon their pools, and upon every reservoir of their waters, that they may become blood. And blood shall be throughout all the land of Egypt, both in wooden and stone vessels. So they did that. Verse 20. And Moses and Aaron did so as the Lord commanded, and he lifted up his rod and struck the waters that were in the river in the sight of Pharaoh and in the sight of his servants, and all the waters in the river were turned to blood. The fish died, the river stank, and the Egyptians could not drink the water of the river. And there was blood throughout all the land of Egypt. Now notice verse 22. And all the priests of Egypt did so with their secret arts, and Pharaoh's heart was hardened, and he would not hearken to them as the Lord had said. Now then, here we come to the third one, frogs. Have you ever seen the giant frogs of the Nile? Whoopee-doo, they are big. Now verse 2, chapter 8. And if you refuse to let them go, I'm going to strike all your country with frogs. And the river shall bring forth frogs abundantly, and they shall go up and come into your houses and into your bedrooms and in upon your bed and into the house of your servants and upon your people and into your ovens and into your kneading troughs. Imagine what a tremendous thing that was. And the frogs shall come upon you and upon your people and upon all your servants. And the Lord spoke to Moses, say to Aaron, stretch out your hand with your rod over the streams and over the rivers and over the ponds and cause frogs to come up upon the land of Egypt. And so he did it. And the frogs came up and covered the land of Egypt. Now notice, the priest did so with their secret arts and brought frogs up upon the land of Egypt. So there is a certain limited power that looks miraculous from Satan. Now then on the next plague was to cause lice to be through the whole land of Egypt. But this time when the priests were called for, notice, what happened? Verse 18, and the priests did so with their secret arts to bring forth lice, but they could not. So there were lice upon man and beast, and the priest said to Pharaoh, this is the finger of God. So God's power is always greater. So there is not to be so-called Christian witches, so-called good witches. There are to be none. So I hope this helps you understand there cannot be such a thing as Christian witches. Now, you need this book that I mentioned. I'll tell you about another one here, two more. Number one, why is Christianity failing in America? Because Christianity does not have the power of God the way that it should. It has the traditions of men. And another one, now that you know this, Lord, what should I do? What should you do? You're living in a world that Satan is controlling. You've got to come out of this world. What should you do? Then the third book, Occult Holidays or God's Holy Days, which? So I hope that you request these books. We'll send them to you at no cost. So once again, this is Fred Coulter saying, thank you for inviting me into your home. So until next time, so long, everyone.